Good morning and welcome on board Safari Live this morning. We've got good news. There has been a new addition given birth to last night into this wildebeest herd. And there are now not one, but two tiny little calves. And we're just waiting for the bull of this herd to escort his harem of ladies into this open clearing. And it's been quite fascinating watching him kind of clear the path and make sure that there's no possible threats ahead of the herd, the ladies with their young little calves, which you are about to see. Viem actually said, who's on camera with me this morning, said, let's go and spend some time with these wildebeest and hopefully we'll get to film one of them giving birth. So that's our plans initially this morning. It's a bit cloudy and there is a chance of rain. I don't think it's going to be the biggest downpour, but even if it starts drizzling, that may become problematic for us. My name's Scott, if you haven't met before. And let's move forward a little bit. The rest of the herd is on their way. I just wanted to clear out of their way a little bit initially because I think they thought that we were looking at some lion here, so they were a bit hesitant of joining us in this little open clearing. We've got James out in the other vehicle and Nikki and Kirsty in the final control room. And good morning to Julia. And thank you for sending in a question so quickly. You want to know if it rained last night? Not that I'm aware of, Julia. I don't think we got any precipitation last night, but it certainly looks like we could get some this morning, like I said. So this is the mighty bull who's been making sure his ladies are escorted safely into this big open clearing. Now you can see the very large belly of a female who has yet to give birth to her calf this season. And maybe she will provide us with our first wildebeest birth on camera. Last year we were lucky enough to film 5 different wildebeest births, one of which was on my very first drive here at Safari Live. It was such a wonderful call you may have heard faintly there, the call of a zebra. There's my little impersonation. One of my favorite calls and not one that you hear very often. Now that can be a bit of an alarm call, so we'll keep that in mind. Maybe it was just two zebras having a conversation, or zebra will let that call out if they are being chased by lion. Now Brent saw the first wildebeest calf yesterday afternoon and he said he did spend time with this herd yesterday morning and there was no calves around. So one calf was born between drives yesterday, another one was born between drives last night, and we've laid eyes on it just a few moments ago, and we are hoping that we'll be able to introduce you to both of these youngsters very soon. Ooh, Vim spotted a little wound there. Interesting. Let me get out my binoculars and see if I can work out what's happened there. All spotted, VM. And I'm sure a lot of you may have even spotted that wound before I did. Oh, hard to say what that could be from. I think it may have maybe just run into a branch or something like that. Although at this time of the year, some strange things are happening, and that's because we are experiencing a drought. And just yesterday, a buffalo bull charged the tiny little wildebeest. Process of popping, and we are hoping that one will pop for us this morning. Big, all three of them there, little teenagers. than last year's additions to the herd. Now, but certainly more food going around than there is in the winter months when it's very, very dry and dusty. Okay, good news everyone, we have finally caught up with the rest of the herd, or the rest of the herd has caught up with that initial portion that we were viewing, and we are in for some good views of the young calves. Let me just get into a spot. They seem to be following the bull who's clearing the pathway up ahead, and if we wait here we should have them all streaming past us. This is going to be awesome. I'm not sure, too sure which of the calves was born yesterday and which was the one born last night. But here's one of them. Look at how cute that is. You can see the umbilical cord sticking out there still. Oh, and this is what I was hoping for. They are so energetic and playful, and to watch them bounce around like this is so cool. Isn't it phenomenal how quickly they learn to walk? I mean, that is within hours of being on the planet, and if you think how long it takes us to get onto our 2 feet and moving around, I guess a lot of respect should be given to these animals. Well, the second calf is just in front of us now. Which one looks older or younger? Now, I think this is the most recently born one. Look at how cute this is. Its mother's quite rough with it, but I mean, that's part of growing up in the wild. But this one, to me, looks a little bit more shaky on its legs, and its coat even looks a little bit more wet than the other one. So I think this is the newest addition to the herd. Okay, well, we've just got a question through from two twins. I know Alyssa was asking about twins earlier. This is Andrew and Michael, and they're watching with Barbara. And they would like to know, what will happen when the wildebeest give birth? Will they do it out in the open? Do they lie down? And the only time I've seen it, which is once in my life, on my first ever Wild Earth drive, the female was standing up for quite a lot of the time, but then did lie down right at the end for the final push. And she did it out in the open in the quarantine clearing. So basically, Andrew and Michael and Barbara, it could very well happen in a setting very similar to where we are now. The female, though, that I saw was standing up for a portion of the labor, but then right at the end, like I said, she lay down for the final little push, and then out popped the tiny calf. Great, I want to try and just loop ahead of them one more time, because I fear they may go into some thick bush shortly, so we'll get one more guaranteed view and then we'll leave them, as like I said, they're probably moving into another area, an open area, again being met by the stallion. Sorry, we still got VM, camera's still on, good. To Roger, and Roger's asked a good question. We'd like to know, how many wildebeest on average will survive to adulthood? And I would guess probably about 30% would make it to adulthood, but it will depend hugely on the luck of each individual herd. What we can do in this case is count how many youngsters remain and how many adults are in the herd, and that way we should be able to get an idea of how many of the calves survived from last summer. So I'm just going to do this quickly. Well, let's see, here's one light-headed one in the center of the screen. So that's last year's produce. We've seen three so far guaranteed with these light foreheads. So if it's definitely three teenagers, I think it is only three, possibly four with stray tawns. And there's probably about 12. There's about 12 adults that I can see. Look, the young calves nursing. Awesome. I was too busy counting. I may have missed a beat there. But like I said, it looks like there could be 12 adult wildebeest cheer females and about four of last year's offspring. At a guess, 30%, 33% of last year's young have made it through, Roger, according to my rough calculations here. To Love Three Dogs, a very interesting name you have, and you are spot on with your observations, saying that it's wonderful to see how closely these young calves are following their mothers, and I guess they need to follow them very closely, especially for the first few moments of their life. Oh, this is cool, there's some wattled starlings arriving. Now, these are migratory birds. They just flew in amongst the wildebeest there and landed on the ground. And as Vim zooms in, you'll see a few small birds moving about. They've got bright yellow wattles on their heads. Look at that. You can see the one male there. The males have got the bright head rest. Oh, look, and the little calf's lying down. There's the starling in the foreground on the right. So the males have got the bright heads. The females have got the dull heads. And isn't it cute, that little calf taking a breather? Now, these wattled starlings are not here throughout the year. We don't see them throughout the year. And you'll see that bright, pretty yellow breeding plumage on the head of the males, and it's common for them to follow herds like this, trying to feed on insects that the herbivores flush up as they graze through the veldt. And more are coming in. Look at all of them. Awesome. I didn't explain myself very clearly earlier, so I'm very happy that Gail has sent through an email to questions@wildearth.tv, and she's mentioned, what use is it that the male is heading up ahead of the rest of the herd? Because how is he going to defend them against lion or leopard? And Gail, he's probably not going to defend them against lion or leopard. It's almost like a kind of a self-sacrifice that he's making by being the first one up ahead. He would be the first one to run into trouble, possibly detect trouble. I mean, the ladies are preoccupied, either about to give birth or having just given birth. So their minds aren't as focused possibly as his can be on looking for predators. But like I said, I think it's almost like a self-sacrifice. He goes ahead first. If anything happens, it'll happen to him and not the rest of the herd. Wildebeest will chase certain animals, as will zebra. So there's certain herbivores that will chase animals like leopard and jackal. But lion certainly would not put up any, well, wildebeest would not put up any resistance to lion, and they would run off in the opposite direction as soon as they caught wind of them. Cool. It looks like the herd has relaxed, and it doesn't look like we are in luck with seeing a birth this morning, but maybe we'll pop in and visit them a little bit later. And VM and I are going to start now spreading out on our search to see if there are any predators on the property that may have snuck in last night. And as we head off, you're also going to be heading off and joining James for an update on his vehicle.
Good morning, everybody. Well, you've been welcomed by Scott, and you now know what you're doing if you happen to be a new viewer. My name is James. On camera we have Brian. Hello, Brian.
Hello, James.
And we've just been to try and see if the hyenas are at their den. They are not. This is very distressing. It is a cloudy and slightly soporific day, tinged with a bit of sadness because old Tara is leaving us. And so we are, you know, we move on into the future, forging ahead. But there is a little tinge of sadness in the air. Nice to have the birth of the little wildebeest. I saw one on foot yesterday. It wasn't particularly pleased to see me at all. Our plan this morning was to drive around. On this gent, without the sun sort of giving you a bit of an angle on the ground, it becomes quite difficult to see some of the tracks. Anyway, we're going to keep looking around here, and then I will go towards. Sorry. And then we'll head towards the Weirteller Dam. Let's see if she hasn't popped around there. That's where she was hunting last night. And James Taylor, the original James Taylor, perhaps? I wonder if you wanted to know if she's caught anything yet, or you're wondering if she has caught anything. Well, we haven't seen any evidence thereof, but certainly looking around and hoping that she may have nabbed herself an impala or maybe two babies. This is a real bonus time, and as I'm sure Scott told you, for the predators, because when the herbivores are giving birth, it's pretty easy for them to feed. That's the general plan today. Sorry, Virginia, I believe there's a question from you. I just had the radio exploding in my ear. Something about impala families. It'll come back through again now. A dik-dik. Virginia, you want to know if a dik-dik is part of the impala family. Virginia, there's nothing else in the impala family. They're in a family all on their own. And so they're in the same order, which is the taxonomic group above family, as the impala. But they're not the same family at all. Impala are the only members of their family, and they've remained sort of unchanged apparently for about 1.5 million years. Their fossil record or their anatomy has not changed as a result of evolutionary pressure. They're such a successful design. So Virginia, the dik-dik is not in the impala family. It's I think it's in the Steenbok's family. And if it isn't, it's very closely related to the Steenbok's family. But we don't get them here. So for those of you who don't know, everybody, a dik-dik is a tiny little antelope, sort of the size of a Steenbok, maybe a little bit smaller even. And they're found more in the desert. These are, of course, not dik-diks. They are nyala. A little mother, I think, off to the right-hand side, and then a young male and a lamb. It's a very beautifully quiet and peaceful morning. You would have heard the Diederik's cuckoo going there. And all around often when you stop, you can hear the kind of bleating or not bleating, the kind of strident calling of chicks in nests. No, I don't often find the nests. Well, Scott does, but I seem to be unable to find them. But I can hear some in a dead tree behind us. So those nyala will be spending as much time as they can in the thick bush eating the delicious vegetation, the new stuff, and then they'll go and have some waters. Very self. Now, we had Big Cat Week last week, and part of Big Cat Week, of course, was the Safari Bingo. And Liz W. in San Diego, you were the winner. And you say that you were tremendously excited about going off to Tanzania, and you say you'll probably go in August next year. Liz, I think that sounds like a wonderful time to go there, and I believe this is going to be your first trip to Africa, if not out of the United States. So that's extremely exciting for you. And I must say, I'm pretty jealous. I've never seen the wildebeest streaming across the plains. I've seen the 8 wildebeest streaming across quarantine clearings, but I haven't seen the 2 million that you're going to go and see streaming across the plains of the mighty Serengeti. So I'm very jealous of you. But I hope you have the most wonderful time, and I'm sure you will. Now, yesterday we had a situation where the buffalo, where a buffalo bashed one of the little wildebeest calves. And Nicole, you want to know if that's because perhaps there's drought and so the animals are more aggressive than they might be otherwise at this time of the year? Nicole, they will get more protective over the water, certainly, but it's not unusual for adult animals of other species to have a go at youngsters from other species, simply because the youngsters, if they're around and bleating and making a noise, attract predators. So often you'll find zebra, if zebra will attack baby wildebeest, if they're not very well protected by their parents. And in the same way, I think that's probably why that buffalo gave the young wildebeest a bit of a knock yesterday, basically saying, get out of here, we don't want you to be around us attracting predators. So I think that's probably got something to do with it. I'm not convinced that it had too much to do with the water stress, but that said, certainly around that little pan there will start to be increasing competition as it dries out. And I mean, although there's a whole lot of cloud above us today, I don't think we're going to get any rain. Brian, do you think we're going to get rain?
Probably not.
So it is very thick cloud, but one or two little drips of rain, not much. And just still on the subject of the dryness and the drought, Nicole, you want to know if it affects mating. Not for the antelope. Remember, the antelope and the buffalo and most of the animals will try and time it so that their babies are born round about now and into December. And so the mating will take place obviously a long time before this. In the case of the impala, will take place around May. In the case of the wildebeest, a little bit earlier than that. And the zebras around January time. And I mean, only the impala really time it to perfection like they do. But certainly the wildebeest are not far off. And the things like zebra and giraffe and other animals like that will mate and try and have their babies around this time. So it doesn't really affect mating for the antelope. Here's some tracks. No, there's a hyena. In terms of the carnivores, they tend to be very unseasonal in their breeding, except the wild dogs. So it won't really affect them. But what it might affect is birds. Now birds, of course, do a lot of mating, sometimes before the wet season, sometimes during the wet season. And I suspect it might push some of the mating behavior for the birds out, but I'm not really sure. I think it will have far more effect on how many young survive. Young will definitely struggle in a drought, but perhaps not so much the mating. Very, very interesting consideration coming through here from Rolf. Rolf? Sorry, I'm just looking at a bird flying overhead. It wasn't particularly impressive, so we won't ask Brian to make you nauseous by flinging the camera at it. Rolf, you want to know if predators will pay more attention to pregnant antelope or pregnant herbivores? Yeah, I think they will. Absolutely. I think that there's definitely a knowledge of which animals are pregnant and which aren't. I think that there's probably a pheromonal scent that they can pick up. And certainly I think a heavily pregnant female would be targeted by a predator because they're slower and they're obviously more of a meal. So yes, Ralph, I think that's definitely a possibility. I haven't read anything about that, but I think it's certainly a possibility. But we're going to head up to the north now and see if we can't find more tracks of Karula. And part of Big Cat Week, of course, was the safari bingo, and one of the safari bingo items that we had was a pineapple. A very strange thing to have, but you know, when your masters tell you to take a piece of fruit on game drive, that's what you do. Ex-Ranga, the pineapple was consumed the day after our third prime time show, and I'm not sure that it will ever make another appearance on game drive. So thanks for that, Ex-Ranga. Let's head across to Scott. He's got a, he's got something tall to show you. A little tall something. See you just now.
Very good, welcome back. We have found some of the taller members of Djuma and Arathusa. And we're just trying to get you into a good spot to enjoy a view of them. Which I feel, we shall get quite shortly. Here's Mom on the left, as you can see. And stop right now, and you can see Junior. It's not the smallest of giraffes, but it is a youngster, and they are incredibly cute. But unlike the wildebeest, I still haven't got a confirmed gestation period for the wildebeest. But what I can assure you is that wildebeest have got a far shorter gestation than giraffe, who have 15 months and therefore cannot plan according to the rainy seasons when they give birth. So I'm not sure exactly when this giraffe calf would have been born, but like I said, it isn't unlike animals like zebra, wildebeest, impala, who give birth around November and December every year. Oh, well, I got lucky and my guesses with the wildebeest gestation periods were correct. And almost exactly between 240 and 270 days. So at least we can confirm that. I find it incredible how these relatively thin legs can hold up such a big body. Wonderful animals, the giraffes, with quite a complex anatomy. Mitaliam has just asked whether safari guides ever have the ability to be able to assist Mother Nature. I'm just going to try and reposition ever so slightly while I answer your question, Mitaliam. By help, she means kind of helping with irrigation or planting trees or grass. And to be honest, Metalian, we have the wonderful situation that the less we do, the better for Mother Nature, as a general rule. And these ecosystems look after themselves far better than us as humans can ever hope to do so. And in the Kruger National Park, which is the greater national park that we are open to, we are a part of a massive transfrontier national park that is over 3 million hectares in size. And because this natural ecosystem is so large, the animals look after themselves and Mother Nature looks after themselves. So we have got very little reason to help or assist the animals in any way. And the best thing we can do is simply watch them and not interfere with their daily ongoings. So the only time that we will, or maybe not us personally, but park wardens will intervene with animals is if they've been injured by humans, like a car crash or something like that, an unforeseen human-related incident. that's caused animals discomfort, or if the animals are endangered or under threat. Ah, well done, Vim. You spotted the youngster again, which we haven't had a good view of until now, so that's wonderful. So, Metalian, I guess just to finish off, there is very little or no obligations or roles for us outside of finding animals for people to enjoy viewing and then telling them as much as you can about them. And that's ideal, I think. The ideal system is one that we do not get involved in. Now, Cecilia in Maryland asks a very good question. A, do giraffes have vocal cords? And B, if they do, why don't they ever use them? Well, they can make noises, Cecilia, but I've only heard it on a few very random events. So they are essentially silent animals, but recent studies have shown that they hum, especially at night, and they're not sure what this humming means exactly. Let's try and reposition one more time here, because you're not getting the best views. So they don't have any conclusive kind of theories as to what the humming is all about and what it exactly means, but it is possibly some form of communication between giraffes. But they are essentially one of the most silent animals out here. Roger's just come up with a great description of these animals, saying they are kind of happily awkward but incredibly graceful all at once. And you're right, they kind of don't know whether they're coming or going, and they're very, very bizarre anatomy, which we are getting a unique view of now, certainly contributes to that. What's also interesting, and watch closely next time she walks, is that both of her left legs, her front and rear left legs, will move simultaneously with one another, as will her right legs once they get into a bit of a flow. So now's not a good example of that. But they're one of the only animals that will have both of their left legs or both of their right legs off the ground simultaneously without toppling over. Let's see if, there we go, there we go. So you're getting a better idea of what I'm talking about now. Hello to Pinky Swear in Michigan. And I mentioned earlier that I'm not too sure how old this calf is. But Pinky Swear would like to know, how long would it hang around with its mother for? And for at least a year, but probably closer to 2 years, would be an average age that a young giraffe will spend with its mother. If it's a female, it could well build into a herd, a natal herd. If it's a male, it'll probably move off and join a few other males until he's big enough to compete for ladies, and then probably move alone, or again in a small bachelor herd. So no set rules for giraffe and their herd structures. We could very well be seeing a female like this with several other females and their calves, but in this case it's just the two of them. We've come into this area because apparently Brent and VM drove past here last night and they smelt, Jamie and VM drove past here last night and smelt something that smelt like it had died. So maybe there's a leopard with a kill. But we're not quite in that area just yet. We were on our way to try and sniff it out when we bumped into these giraffes. It's somewhere down there according to VM. So that's some exciting prospects. I like we're gonna get some great views of her feeding here. Look at this. Awesome, look at her tongue. That was really cool to see that long tongue wrapping around these combretum leaves. Hello to Billy, and good question. Where is the father of this young giraffe, and what is its roles and responsibilities? Billy, the roles and responsibilities of this young giraffe's father was simply to help create it. It has no further roles or obligations in parenting the young calf, and that's entirely up to mom. And that's the case with a lot of wild animals. The males will simply be involved in the process of mating and then disappear and may never actually ever see their progeny. This youngster looks like it's found something tasty to chew on, but it's doing so quite apprehensively, almost. Not like it's completely sold by the idea of leaves, and it probably much prefers milk. Look at how short the little black tail tuft is. And keep that in mind, that little mental image of the tail tuft, and we're gonna compare it to mom's now. She's on her way over to the calf. Look at that, awesome. Still got a lot of growing to do, youngster. And mom's tail is certainly more impressive than yours. Oh, is it bath time? Oh, and drink time. Look at how flexible that long neck is. What a crazy view we're getting here. Julia in Houston, thank you for using the correct terminology, saying bilateral movement for the terminology of moving both legs at the same time, and you'd like to know whether they do it when they are running as well. And yes, they certainly do. They perform that same bilateral movement whilst walking and running. To see giraffe running, especially in an open plain, is one of my favorite things. It looks like a slow motion affair, but it certainly isn't. They can move at high speeds of around 30 miles an hour. There's some beautiful bird song this morning. Chagras calling. The woodlands kingfishers are fairly quiet so far. Oh, well, breakfast's over just like that. Back to leaves. And hello to Sarah. Welcome on board Safari with us. It's great to have you along. And Sarah's interested to know, how do these giraffes defend themselves against predators? Well, they've got a great ability to be able to detect predators long before they're a threat, and they do that with their permanent vantage point being so tall. What can you see though? Are you just making sure that there's no vehicles coming before you cross the road? Are you scared of snakes? Have you seen a snake down there? No? Okay, just practicing safe road crossing. Very good. As I was saying though, Sarah, being so tall, they can often see predators long before they actually pose a threat to them. But their size is probably their biggest defense against predators. Because they are so large, leopard cannot feed on adult giraffe, but young giraffe, like the one we're looking at now, can be caught and killed more often than not by big male leopards, not so much the females. But even lions, the biggest of the African predators, have got a difficult business in taking down giraffe. They are so tall and big and strong. And with those big legs, those hooves can deliver very, very painful, if not potentially fatal blows as they kick out. So lion can be unceremoniously hoofed off a giraffe if they are not careful. So those, I guess, are the main defense mechanisms. And some of you may remember a picture that was circulating of the Anderson male leopard, and he had a young giraffe up a tree. Something I've never seen before, but it is something that can happen out here. Okay, probably, oh no, the young calf's just disappeared behind a bush again. But let's give it a moment or two. It may continue across here to join mom. And I've got a funny feeling, and I'm hoping I'm right, that it may run. And then we'll get to see it running. Let me just get the vehicle positioned correctly for this. I'm hoping the young calf is going to provide Julia and Houston with some bilateral running. And it's got such furry little Aussie cones, those horn-like structures on its head. Come on, give us a run. But you can see the bilateral movement now very clearly, everyone. Look at this. Almost like a soldier marching, left, right, left, right. There we go. Come on, please run for us. Run across the road. Be more daring than your mother, who stopped and made extra sure that there was nothing crossing. No? Okay, well, sorry, Julia and Houston, you didn't get to see it running, but at least you got to see it walking through an open clearing. And thank you for bringing up the topic of hyenas and them moving bilaterally, and that they also have a bilateral movement when they're moving slowly, but not so much when they're running, and they've got a kind of cantering lope or strange kind of lope that they will perform when they are running that's not quite bilateral. And I guess what's also interesting about hyenas is how they've got their kind of sloping hind quarters with regards to their front quarters, or comparison to their front quarters, which are used to house the large lungs and hearts, the stamina equipment that allows hyena to move such huge distances, they're specially designed for. Of the smell, but Vim, he was on camera with me, has just spotted one of the smallest antelopes in this area, the steenbuck. It's probably only knee high. That's a female, and you may have got a glimpse of another one, which was the male. You can see through that little gap in the bushes there, she's got no horns. The male, who is her husband, they form monogamous bonds. Oh, he's also hidden there in the bush. Well done, Vim. You may be able to see some pencil sharp horns poking out of his head. And off they go. Oh, the giraffe needs to teach you a thing or two about crossing roads. Little steenbuck, that was very reckless. I mean, didn't even look once, not even one side. Hello to Molly. And Molly's interested to know which kind of giraffe do we see here in South Africa. And we only see the southern giraffe. There are about 9 different subspecies of giraffe through Africa, but we only get one that occurs naturally in South Africa. Further up in Kenya and Tanzania, where I've spent some time in my life, you get the Rothschild's giraffe, the reticulated giraffe, the Maasai giraffe, 3 different giraffe in quite a small area.
My favorite giraffe
being the reticulated. And what I'll do is I'll very quickly get my book out for you, Molly, and show you some pictures of the different giraffe. Now, do I take a gamble and just page through like I'm doing now until I get to the index, I think, where I can check properly? This is the best option, Molly. Giraffe, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, 96. Very good. Ah, and isn't it wonderful that the reticulated giraffe, my favorite, is the first one, the first specimen that you can see on the top left. And you can see how each individual block or pattern is very distinct. The marking between brown and white is a very clear line. Whereas the Maasai or Kenyan giraffe is more similar to our giraffe, the southern giraffe, but its pieces are kind of more flaky, you could say, in a way, more individual segments or shards of brown. Now, if we go down, you'll see what I mean. The southern giraffe, the one we get over here, has got more regular kind of block shapes. The Rothschild's giraffe has got very white legs and is probably the most endangered of all the giraffe. Great, well, there's at least four different types. There's also no other pictures of the other variables that you get here, just of a few youngsters. But there we go, Molly. The southern giraffe is the one we get here. But my favorite is the reticulated, which you get up in central Kenya. Central and northern Kenya. Good morning to Mike in Florida, and really well done on your bird list. 187 specimens so far. Mike, please do me a favor and let me know what we can try and find you, what's missing off your list. And if we don't have any luck tracking down predators today, we might be able to find a rare bird. What's old starling not on, or already on your list, Mike? Because we got that earlier this morning. I'm not sure when you jumped on board with us, but we did get wattled starling earlier. Okay, well, Vim and I are going to be doing our best to sniff out whatever it was that smelt fishy in this area last night. And we're going to send you back to James for a quick update on how he's doing.
Right, well, we have failed to find Karula at this stage, but we're still searching with great enthusiasm at the road to see if we can find any tracks. We did find a couple of buffalo bulls who looked at us with a disdain, so we moved on from them while you were looking at the little giraffe. Now, I'm told that Mike in Florida, you have a bird list of 186, which I think, given that you live in Florida, is an immensely impressive list. 187, sorry, I do apologize. I think that we should have a small competition amongst the viewers. Mike's at 187. Is there anybody who has a larger bird list than that? It'd be lovely to know. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at WildEarthTV. Tell us what your bird list is if you happen to be ornithologically inclined. I know that many will not be, but I know that there are a few of you that keep wonderful lists of birds. There's a lovely bird I've just heard called the black-headed oriole, of course, which many of you will have seen. But I think one of the most beautiful birds of this time of the year is called the European golden oriole, and it's an amazing bright yellow color with black wings. Very seldom see them other than when they are running, at least flying. I said running because I've just seen a duiker flying across the sky. There is a duiker. Hello, duiker. Don't run away. There we go. It is our second smallest antelope here. The smallest, of course, being the steenbok. This one's about 17 kilograms.
17 times 2.2 is much too difficult for me to do at this time of the year. Time of the day.
Steering book about 11 kilograms. That times 2.2 is at 28 pounds. Hello, Debbie. You are ornithologically minded. You want to know if there are ostriches around. I've never seen one here. Brian, you haven't seen one here, but you have seen one. So Brian's seen one once in this area. So definitely, I mean, I've seen them in a similar area to this once or twice. It's not quite open enough. They do like open areas where they can see and they can use their incredible speed to get away from potential predators. They will fall prey to lions and hyenas and sometimes to leopards. But you definitely get them in the Kruger Park, Debbie. Try and add to Mike's list. Oh, and Mike, anybody else who's ornithologically minded, and Mike, if you want, let us know what specific species you think you might be missing from your list, and we'll endeavor to find them for you. And also let us know if you are prepared to take the call, or if you have to actually see it to get it. Every so often you will see us rushing headlong down a road, seemingly out of control, and that is indeed because we are out of control. Brent Leo Smith managed to detach the brake line on Wendy yesterday evening, and so we're running without brakes today. Dean in Los Angeles, if we do lose signal, we'll come back to you now, but wonderful. You say you want to get a close-up of a wattled starling. You say you've got over 100, or that would be your 100th Safari Live bird picture. That's wonderful, Dean. We'll definitely try that. So I think you are going to lose us. We're on our way to Bivelshoek Dam to see what's going on there. But if you do use the other side. Such a muggy day. All right, let's go across to Scott and see what he's got for you. I'll see you the other side of this black hole.
Welcome back, and sadly, James is evidently in a bad signal area, which happens from time to time. Whilst on these live safaris, you get to see all the glitches as well as the glory in between. I want to turn off this radio quickly. That was going to be providing us with updates from Arathusa, but all I heard were a few crackles. Might head across there a bit later, but would like to continue checking Djuma before we do go across to Arathusa. And here we have a bachelor herd of impala, all different shapes and sizes, some young males from last year, and a few big, old, established males. This is a good example of how the males have got very little, oh wonderful, very little need or requirements when it comes to parenting. We got this Billy's question from earlier, and you can see they're all just on holiday now. You've been left behind, buddy. Oh, no you haven't. You're about to catch up. Good decision. You don't want to be left alone out here, and the more eyes and ears you have around you, the safer your life becomes. Okay, now I fear we also may lose signal shortly, because we are also going through a bit of a low signal area. But let's hold tongues. It's really interesting, the technical side of what goes on here. I know very little about it, but what I do know is that signal fluctuates on a daily basis, and the vehicle that James is in had great signal just a few days ago, and then all of a sudden yesterday it started playing up again. So they need permanent care and nurturing. Mary in Michigan. Good morning, and very happy to hear you are interested to know about the walking safaris and whether or not we will still be doing them even though Big Cat Week is finished. And yes, Mary, we certainly will be. We all love doing the bushwalks. Jamie also needs to get involved there. She's fully qualified and we just haven't found a space for her to do much bushwalks yet. So that's something for you all to look forward to, is to be spending some time on foot with her, along with the rest of us on foot. So yes, we certainly will, but how exactly and when exactly, we're not too sure. Obviously, we ramp up our crew quite drastically for the Big Cat Weeks. And now we will have, from there being in excess of 30 people in the camp for Big Cat Week, we are down to Viam and myself on this vehicle, James and Brian on the other vehicle, Kirsty and Nikki in the final control room. That is a total of 6 of us here making Safari Live happen. So because the numbers have decreased by 5 times, we are... Oh, there's Brent and Jamie as well. Whoops, my bad, I forgot about them. Sorry, Brent and Jamie. It's not because I don't love them dearly and think they are wonderful additions to our crew. So there's 8 of us here. Either way, it's a lot less people, and we are not too sure of the exact plans for how we're going to get you all the great views that you were experiencing in Big Cat Week. Not only are we going to want to be doing the bushwalks, but also the drone and get you up into the sky for some beautiful scenic views. Also, just make sure all that equipment and all of our skills are still honed in those various departments. We will be doing it as often as we can. Okay, well, this long road that we are heading down now will eventually take us into the area of the Buffalo Waterhole. But thankfully, you will not have to travel down this road with us, which would take about 15 minutes to get to the waterhole, because James is already waiting there for you.
Well, this is quite a sad thing to see, really. And the first time in 20 years, Buffalo's Hook Dam looks like it's going to dry out. I just cannot believe that all that water has disappeared. You can see there are 3 hippo lying in the mud there. How they are tolerating the immense stench of rotting fish from where they're sitting, mixed in, of course, with their dung and the dung of 1,000 buffalo, is anyone's guess. It really is very, not sad, but it's amazing. We've obviously had a very dry year this year, but I think last year's very dry year undoubtedly contributed to the fact that the water table is very low, and that's why this once large water body, once large and proud water body, is now, well, just what it is now, a sort of cesspit of dying fish. Still, that's perfectly normal. There is the undertaker, Marabou Stalk. But the rest of his kin have taken off and gone elsewhere because it's so denuded. I think all those tilapia that died have been eaten by various things. But it really is quite something. Anyway, while we're sitting here, James Bear in Kansas City, you have a Wild Earth or Safari Live bird list of 218. That is really impressive. I mean, I don't believe that the consistent bird list for this area is too much more than 250, so you've done really well there. Let us know which ones you'd like to see from here. We'll try and find some common ones. Brian, how would you describe the smell of this general vicinity?
The tide has come in.
The tide has come in, yes, and rottened. Mm. It's rotted quietly, yeah. Mm. I'm just going to contact Scott on the radio. He's trying to get hold of me. Go ahead, Scott.
Just to Mvubu Road. Copy that, good luck. Scott's just telling me what his route is going to be. He's going to head across to Arathusa, which is our western section of traversing. Wendy at the moment is not in a fit state to go there. You can hear some arrow-marked babblers calling. Oh, Edward, you've got some work to do. You were on 117. Rather, you're in Tucson on 198 bird species. I think that's brilliant. I think anybody who's keeping lists, I think that's just wonderful. Well, Rather, we'll try and get you to 200 before the end of the year. I'm assuming you all have the marabou stork and the red-billed buffalo weaver that is calling above us.
Beep, beep, beep.
Oh, Alan, you're only in 148. And birds that you've seen on a safari live, that's still pretty good, I think. I mean, we don't generally concentrate a huge amount on birds. So I think it's very impressive. I think 218 is a quite astonishing number. I think 198 is also very good. Right, so let's move gently along and we'll see what birds we can find. And then, on the subject of birds, certainly around here, there was a paradise flycatcher. And Chris Rove, you say, did we ever get it? I'm not sure what you mean by get it. But yes, they are around here, definitely. And you could certainly include it. I'm not sure if you were on the drive, but it's certainly been seen around on drive. I think I've seen it once. They're not common here, Chris. But certainly, I have seen them here at Wilkinson. Paradise flycatcher, everybody, is a beautiful sort of chestnut-coloured bird with a blue eye and a long chestnut tail, the male's got. Oh, tracks of hyenas. Question from Rich King. Rich, you wanted to know if ostriches stick their heads in the sand. Rich, that apparently is a legend. They don't. I've certainly never seen them do it, and I've read that that is not in fact the case. I think what you'll probably find is that they do. They feed very close to the ground, and perhaps sometimes when they're digging for roots, they're herbivores. Maybe it looks like they've buried their heads in the sand. No, they are not head buriers by default, no. Nice one, Rich. Now, around the Bivelshoek Dam, not the Bivelshoek Dam, the Djuma Dam, the Vuyatela, little pan there, there is a hippopotamus. And Ava, you want to know if that hippopotamus ever gets out of the water? Yes, he does. At night time, we saw him the other night. He was making a frightful noise. There was a lady in town, a young female hippo, and he was doing the following at her. He was going, there. She didn't think that was a very nice song, and so she left. But certainly he was out of the water, and he will be out of the water eating grass at night. And I mean a couple of people have said to me they think he's on his way out, like he might be going to join his maker fairly soon. I think he looks in pretty good nick, to be honest. I don't, you know, he's got one or two injuries, but I don't think he's looking too skinny. But maybe he's not in great nick. I think he's okay though. So he will come out, Ava, and eat at night, and then as soon as the heat starts to build, or as soon as it looks like it's going to get light, he nips back into his pond and makes sure that no other hippo will come and take it from him. And we
were looking at the other hippo there, lying in what looked like a sort of cesspit of mud, which is indeed what it was. Lucy in South Bend, Indiana. Right. We're just going to stop here and listen for a couple of birds. Lucy, you want to know if... you want to know if those hippo could ever get stuck in that mud. Hippo, very unlikely, Lucy, because they're so used to the water, they know what's going on in water, and so it's highly unlikely that they would get stuck. But certainly elephants will get stuck sometimes, young elephants, and some other buffalo maybe, and possibly even young antelope. It's normally inexperienced animals that get stuck in mud like that. But that place there will certainly be something that they will be very careful of. Elephant herds coming through there, mothers will be very careful of letting their calves go anywhere near that particular area. I'm just trying to hear if we've got anything unusual. There is actually a bird calling. It's called a neticky. So that's a neticky. So from a ridiculously tiny little brown bird with a fairly pretty call, it's head across to Scott, who is not a bird at all, but a man. Fine example thereof, and some elephants with him. We'll carry on this way.
Now, we've just caught a glimpse of this young calf. It seems to be moving quite quickly after its mother. And they're moving down into a very thick riverbed where it is inaccessible with the vehicle, sadly. So I fear these may be the last fleeting glimpses of this young elephant calf. Now, I know you guys have been chatting a lot with James about birds. What I forgot to mention, and this is going to make some of the ornithologists very jealous, is that I saw an incredibly beautiful bird the other day, and it is one of the waxbills. It's called a violet-eared waxbill, and it is such an impressive bird that I'm going to get it out in my book and show it to you. They're not very common in this area, so that was a very cool one to see, and hopefully it won't take us too long before we find one to show you now, because the alien's disappeared. We're gonna probably leave it to its own devices and show you. This entire page of birds is actually remarkable. They're all very small birds though. So, VM, you can start any corner you like and I'll go through them. The common waxbill is probably the least impressive of all of them, but remember, they are such small birds that unless you get binoculars onto them, you often don't realize their beautiful colorations. This is the violet-eared waxbill. How awesome is that bird? And then as VM goes down, you'll see the blue waxbills. These are fairly common, but again, easily overlooked because of their tiny size. And then look at how awesome the pink-throated twin spots is, along with the green-winged Pytilia below that. I mean, some really impressive birds, all of which occur here in the Greater Kruger National Park. But the violet-eared waxbill, I'm sure, is one that a lot of you would like to add to your list, and we will be trying our best to do so, to find that for you. It was around Impala Plains, so whenever any of us are driving around Impala Plains and the power lines, remind us or urge us to look for those little waxbills. Oh, did you hear some crackles on the radio? It sounded like possibly there's some action going on across that Arathusa. So we have now diverted. We are no longer heading east towards the Buffles of Warsaw general area that we were heading in, and we are now heading south and eventually west back towards Arathusa. Coming through from Siberia, Zumi, one of the people who controls the Warthog camera. For those of you who do not know what a Zumi is, we've got a live camera, and the Zumis have the joy of being able to control where that camera looks. Now, Siberia says that I don't remember us seeing a cormorant, which is a water bird, and maybe that's just because of the low water at the moment. And we did see them at Buffalo's of Warthog. We used to see some white-breasted cormorants over there, so I know for certain we have got them on camera in the year that I've been here, but they're not hugely common in this area. And you'll probably find now that it is very dry, they are frequenting the Sand River and the Sabi River, which flow through this reserve, or are bigger water sources elsewhere. But you're right, Siberia, we haven't seen a cormorant for quite some time, but we have definitely seen them before. The white-breasted cormorant is one we've seen. You'll also get the reed cormorant here, which is a lot smaller. Wonderful hearing a lot of new names coming through. And oh, this is a bird's eye view on an Inyala. Big bull. Look at his little ivory tips there on the tops of his horns. Signs of a big male. Now, I'm not too sure what's going on with his nostrils, but it appears like he's taking a few deep breaths of the fresh morning air as he chews the cud. Hello, old man. As I was saying there, we're getting questions through from a lot of new names and faces, so good to have some new people on safari with us. The next one is from Monkey Man. And Monkey Man would like to know, what storks do we get here? We get a host of different storks, Monkey Man. Of saddlebill storks that used to spend a lot of time at this dried up waterhole sadly aren't here anymore. Very pretty storks. Those are here throughout the year along with the marabou stork and the woolly necked storks. But we also get some storks that migrate. The white stork or European stork come from Mediterranean Europe to come for our summer. We haven't seen any of those yet. What other storks am I forgetting about? The marabou storks, another monster of a stork. So the marabou, the woolly necks, the abdons, the yellow billed. Probably about 6 or 7 different stork species that we get out here. To Margaret in Kansas, and you've just reminded me of a spectacular bird that we sadly do not get here, the superb starling. But you do get them up in East Africa. That's where I've seen the majority of my superb starlings. Some tiny little impala lambs here, and just like the wildebeest calves we saw earlier, they pronk and run around so joyfully. It's such a pleasure to watch them bounding through the bush, always keeping very close to their mother's sides. Look at their little tails wagging. And it's a wonderful time of year to be exploring with you guys, with all the new growth and babies around. Even though we're in a drought, it's still a wonderful time of the year, and there's a lot of life and joy to be seen and shared. But these impala mothers have done the right thing and moved away from any potential threats, taking utmost care of their little lambs. And because they have disappeared, we are going to send you across back to James.
Right. We had a hornbill, but unfortunately the hornbill flew away. But I'm sure those of you who are keeping your bird lists, probably yellow-billed hornbill was the first bird on your list. We haven't seen anything other, anything else great note bird-wise, or indeed mammal-wise, or indeed anything-wise since we last saw you. We're heading now down to the south of the reserve along the eastern fringes. We're not quite on the eastern boundary. That's just about sort of 200 or 100 meters to the left of your screen, to the eastern side of us. That's 330 feet. You're still working with feet. Ah, there is a Nyala bull. Nyala, do not run away. No, no. Let's go a little bit forward. Big bird behind there. It's flown thick bush. There is a Nyala bull. Isn't he lovely? Magnificent animal. And very different from the females, the only antelope that show this incredible sexual dimorphism. Remember, we saw the Nyala cows earlier on, sort of chestnut colored. And this bull is, well, just gray and dark and charcoal, really. They're certainly my favorite antelope out here. Now, he clearly doesn't want to see you as much as you want to see him. It's probably me, actually. Very strange weather this is. No sort of change in temperature. Thick, heavy cloud. There he is. Browsing away, and the bulls will live on their own, but sometimes they live with sort of in proximity to a nursery herd. And I wonder if there isn't another little group of females and the youngsters around here. Very kind of odd arrangement of hair. I mean, to have that much hair in a climate like this is really not a particularly clever idea. And I think they probably have to spend quite a lot of time living in thick bush to maintain any kind of cool in their body temperatures. Hello, Anthony Del Gatto. I'm not sure I've heard from you before. Anthony, you ask a very valid question, and one that we need to address relatively often, because especially to people who are new to this kind of thing, the fact that we are driving around elephants and... What's wrong, Brian? Brian's being attacked by a horsefly. Don't worry, if you hear a scream, it's because that bitten his finger off. Anthony, you want to know about the danger associated with being here. You've probably seen us sitting in close proximity to lions and leopards and elephants, buffalo, that hippo. You want to know if the animals ever get aggressive with us. I don't think that it's fair to term any animal aggressive out here. I'd go so far as to say that I don't think it's fair to call any animal even dangerous out here. Animals become aggressive, they become dangerous when they are threatened. We as the apex predator, the animals see us as the apex predator, they are afraid of us. If we corner an animal, then they will react in an aggressive manner in exactly the same way as if you were cornered by a gangster, say, you might, instead of running away, you will then eventually turn around and have to fight. So it's very much a case of trying to understand how the animals see us, and once you do that, they actually react normally in a predictable fashion. Yes, of course, there can be an incident where you step around the bush and there's a buffalo asleep and he gets a fright and he'll bash you. It's very few and far between, and I'd say it's far less dangerous living here than it is in, say, a big city. That's not to say that we aren't extremely respectful, extremely careful around the animals. We watch their behavior very carefully. But Anthony, in terms of aggression, an animal only ever becomes aggressive if it's feeling threatened. And it's the way you sort of steer clear of that is to understand what might make an animal feel threatened, what might make an animal react in an aggressive fashion. Good question. Thank you, Anthony. A brilliant idea and question from Miriam about electric Land Rovers, and you say, wouldn't it be a good idea? Yes, you say, is it possible that because it's so quiet, the animals wouldn't hear it coming and it would give them a fright? There's an element of that, Miriam, but I don't think a huge one. I think they would hear our voices, and certainly when we're on foot, sometimes we try and be quiet, and sometimes we will let the animals know that we're there by clicking or just making the odd sound. And I think we'd do the same thing in an electric Land Rover. The reserve I used to work on had one electric Land Rover. At the moment, I'm not convinced that the technology is that effective. It's, you need a lot of power to operate a machine like this and to do some of the stuff that we do. The electric Land Rover where I used to work burst into flames one day, which of course is not a really great thing if you're trying to give six people a safari experience. And it's generally accepted that you want your car to stay out of flames. No one was hurt in the incident. And so the technology, I don't believe, exists just yet. I'm sure it's very close. But you need quite a lot of torque, quite a lot of power. And certainly I think that the number of battery cells that you need to operate a vehicle like this would be too many at the moment. But Miriam, that's definitely the direction in which we'd be heading. If there was an electric Land Rover that was completely silent, that's absolutely what we'd use. It always amazes me, you turn the engine off and then suddenly the incredible sounds of the bush come out. And I'm no doubt that we do miss the odd bird that's alarm calling at a predator, possibly the, impala alarm calling in the distance, or kudu alarm calling in the distance. I'm sure we miss that quite a lot, simply because of the engines. And these engines are very quiet compared with a lot of the diesels that are used. But still, I think we do miss them. So Miriam, yeah, absolutely. If there was an electric option, we'd most certainly use it.